Good morning, everybody. This is a new seminar organized by the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía in Granada. And today we will have the talk by Dr. Beatriz Gis González. And she will talk about the optical polarization of radio quiet active galactic nuclei. Beatriz will be properly introduced by Dr. Josefa Macegosa. Please, goodbye.
Hello, good morning. It's really a pleasure to introduce Bea Agis because I will take the opportunity to introduce to everybody in the institute because she got. Excuse me. She recently incorporated in our group with a postdoc for 3 years. And so we are very happy because of that. And I will say something about her. She obtained the bachelor degree in La Laguna, and also the master. And after that, she went to the Centro de Astrobiología in Madrid. She was working with Giovanni Minuti and did a PhD on variability studies at X-ray frequencies and optical frequencies of AGNs. And in 2017, she moved to the University of Lieja in Belgium, and she has been working there in polarization studies of AGNs with Dr. Damien Hussemaker, and now she came to the institute to work also in variability. And we are very happy because we don't know much about polarization, so she will train us about this new field. So that thank you Bea for your availability for giving this talk, and so that she will be around. I think in April, at the beginning of April, after spring holidays. So that's so. Bea, as you want, you press it.
Your micro, Bea. No.
Bea,
you need to unmute.
I don't listen to you because you have to disactivate your mic.
Now?
You have to unmute. Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, sorry. Thank you, Bepa, for your presentation. My aim with this talk is to give you an idea of how useful is polarization in the AGN field, although unfortunately this technique is still little used despite its potential. With that aim in mind, I will start introducing what is an AGN and how polarization arises in these objects, as well as the unification model of AGNs, which is necessary because of their complex morphology. And lastly, I will explain what is a tiny look AGN and a true 2 AGN, which can be a particular case of true 2. Then I will briefly review the polarization properties of radio quiet AGN in the optical range and how they give us valuable information about the unresolved AGN structure. Finally, I will explain how polarization works as a diagnostic tool for changing look AGN and as confirmation tool for true 2 AGN, as well as some related ongoing projects. So, active galactic nuclei, or AGN, are the intrinsically non-transient brightest objects in the universe, producing very high luminosities from a very concentrated volume, namely from an unresolved region. It is generally accepted that accretion onto a supermassive black hole is at the origin of this huge release, which is a spread along the whole electromagnetic spectrum from radio up to gamma rays. We are quite sure there is a supermassive black hole in the core of these energetic monsters because of their spectral features. Actually, AGNs are classified according to their optical spectra in two types. Type 1 AGN present both broad and narrow emission lines, and type 2 AGNs only show narrow lines. Broad emission lines with full width high maximum of thousands of kilometers per second are the proof that there exists material moving at very high luminosities under the gravitational influence of a supermassive black hole. Obviously, this broadening of the emission lines is produced in the innermost regions where the influence of the supermassive black holes giving its effects. While narrow emission lines with full width high maximums of some hundreds of kilometers per second arise in outermost regions. Now, why broad line disappear in the spectra of type 2 AGN? In this context, Robert Antonucci establishes the unified model of AGN, whose key element is this absorbing toroidal structure which blocks the view of the broad line region when the inclination respect to the symmetry axis of the system is high enough, so that the broad lines will disappear in type 2 spectrum. But lower inclinations allow both broad and narrow emission lines to be present in the spectrum. The definite proof confirming this model is the finding of polarized broad lines in type 2 AGNs. The emission from the broad line hidden by the torus is scattered in the cones situated outside the torus and aligned with its symmetry axis known as polar scattering region, which acts. Which acts as a mirror reflecting the broad components toward us. 30 years ago, this fact established the inclination of our line of sight respect to the symmetry axis of the system as the key parameter controlling the existence of the broad lines in the AGN spectra. However, nowadays, additional ingredients are likely needed to account for some observational facts that are apparently in conflict with these predictions. One of these observational facts are changing look AGNs that undergo change of spectral classification, namely transients from type 1 to type 2, where broad emission lines disappear, or transient from type 2 to type 1, where broad emission lines appear, accompanied respectively by a dimming or a brightening of the continuum in time scales as short as months. So these objects proves that the AGN classification is not only angle dependent absolutely. There exist two main possible explanations for this exceptional change in the optical spectra of AGN. When the inclination of the source is such that our line of sight intercepts a cloud or a clump from the upper layers of the torus, relative rapid change in the observed flux can occur when the observing material moves to allow or block a clear view of the central region of the AGN, resulting in disappearing or appearing broad emission lines. Nevertheless, change of look observed in low luminosity AGNs, namely Seyfert galaxy, are in some cases convincingly explained by variable obscuration. But in most high luminosity agents, namely quasars, the time scale of the change of look does not agree with the time needed by the clamp to cover entirely the broadline region. So for most changing look quasars detected so far, the more plausible explanation are variations in the accretion rate provoking the switch on or off of the central source. An intrinsic dimming of the central source of the ionizing radiation reduces the number of photons available to ionize the gas, resulting in a net decrease in the emission line intensity. On the contrary, a brightening of the central source will result in an increase of the line intensity. In addition, it is supposed that below a given critical accretion rate or luminosity, no broad lines regions can be sustained nor formed over a long time. Thus, the performed dramatic variability will be driven by intrinsic variations of the accretion rate, either creating or disrupting the broad line region, switching the broad lines on and off. In this scenario, this scenario will give us the magnificent opportunity to prove the broad line region in different evolutionary states by studying different changing looks agents. Besides, the total disappearance of broad emission lines due to variations in the accretion rate will result in true to AGN closing a evolutive cycle. So true to AGN could be a particular case for changing look AGN when the broad emission lines disappear in the optical spectrum. Specifically, the optical spectra true to AGN do not show broad emission lines, which leads to a type 2 classification. According to the unified model, this means that our line of sight is intercepting the obscuring torus. However, in the X-ray domain, true to AGN show an absorbed spectra instead of absorbed. So there is a mismatch between X-ray and optical domains. Precisely, if the broadline region disappears because of a decrease in the accretion rate, we will see an optical type 2 spectra independently of the inclination. Thus, a true 2 candidate will be confirmed as a true 2 AGN if its broadline region is lacking physically and not only observationally. And to prove that a broadline region is not physically present in the optical domain, we should check the optical emission in polarized light, as there can be a broadline region hidden by the torus, as seen before. So let's go now in depth with the origin of these polarized lines in AGN. Most astronomical observations are based on measurements of intensity, either per unit of time or wavelength or both. Polarimetry measures something more, how the electric field vector oscillates. In general, the electric field oscillations are untidy, like in this sketch. There isn't any defined direction for the derivation of the electric field. And in this case, we say the light is unpolarized. When the electric field vibrates most often in a specific direction, light becomes polarized. And this happens when electric field oscillations are perturbed by any mechanisms or element that breaks the symmetry in the radiative source In the case of AGN, those elements can be scattering by particles or dust, the presence of geometrical structures with collimated radiation, or the influence of magnetic fields. Thus, polarization arises every time one of these elements is interposed between the source and the observer, providing us with information about the element responsible for the polarization, thanks to interactions with matter and re-emission processes, even if that element is below the resolution limit of the telescope. Let's remind that the core of AGN are unresolved. Then polarimetry allow us to study the geometry, structure and kinematics, as well the dust structure and mineralogy of these objects without forgetting the magnetic field topology. However, in this talk, we are focusing radio quiet AGN, and in source the magnetic field is not intense, so I will not discuss about the influences of magnetic fields in AGN polarization, but about their scattering regions and the collimations and the collimation of the central emission by the obscurators. So there are two key magnitudes which define completely the polarization state of an AGN. P, or the polarization degree, telling us how much polarized is the light coming from the source, or theta, or polarization position angle, telling us what is the direction of polarized light respect to the AGN axis, which coincides with the radio axis, the symmetry axis, and the accretion disk axis. All the observational efforts made so far have also led to a unified view of AGN polarization, which is illustrated here. Apart from the torus described before and the accretion disk feeding the supermassive black hole, we have two different scattering regions. The equatorial scattering region is a compact ring-shaped region unresolved, situated along the equatorial plane of the torus, inside the sublimation radio of the dust. Therefore, the scattering in this region is driven mostly by electrons. On the contrary, the polar scattering region is much extended, cone-shaped, and situated outside the torus along the AGN axis. This is the well-established polar scattering region that we described before, and that led Antonucci to establish the unified model of AGN. Light arising from the polar scattering region will be polarized with this polarization position angle perpendicular to the AGN axis, while light arising from the equatorial scattering region will be polarized with its polarization position angle parallel to the AGN axis. This configuration results in strongly orientation dependent polarization properties. When the inclination is close to zero, we have an almost phase on view, and both of the equatorial and the polar scattering regions exhibit a high degree of circular symmetry in projection, and therefore cancellation leads to null or very low polarization. At intermediate inclinations, there is no extinction along our line of sight to the nucleus. So both scattering regions are seen, and this will generate the cancellation between both. Usually the equatorial scattering region component is stronger, therefore the net polarization is parallel while the direct spectrum is a type one. When the inclination is comparable to the torus opening angle, the direct line of sight to the nucleus passes through the relative tenuous upper layers of the torus, which is already capable of attenuating the equatorial scattering light and lets polar scattering dominate, while the direct broad emission lines can survive to these low extinctions, giving rise to direct type 1 spectra. At the larger inclinations, both the equatorial scattering region and the broad line region are blocked by the torus, so disappears of our view, and sorry, I have a dismiss here. So, since the equatorial scattering region and the broad line region is blocked by the torus, The directed spectrum is that of type 2 with a high polarization, since the equatorial scattered light is also blocked. This is a brief general interpretation of polarization of quiet of radio quiet AGN, but there exist open questions, as if both scattering regions are simultaneously present in every AGN, if the equatorial scattering region is inside or outside the broadline region, and while the polar scattering region can be resolved and identified in nearby safer galaxies, the nature of the equatorial scattering region is more elusive, since it is unresolved in direct light. Regarding the polarization degree, there exists a clear dichotomy for high luminosity AGN quasars. Type 1 presents polarization degrees lower than 2%, while type 2 are highly polarized with polarization degrees higher than 2%. Type 1 quasars at low inclinations lets both equatorial and scattering regions being seen by the observer. The equatorial scattering cancels the polar scattering, and the resulting polarization is low. Whereas in type 2 quasars at high inclinations, the equatorial scattering region is hidden by the torus, and only polar scattering arises at the same time that the resulting polarization is high. However, for safer galaxies, which are the low luminosity counterpart of quasars, this is not clear observed, probably because of the dilution by an additional continuous source, which can be a host galaxy, a partial and absorbed continuum, emission from the scattering region itself, or even a star bands. Actually, safer two galaxies present little polarization, but when they show high polarization degrees, they exhibit polarized broad emission lines, also known as hidden broad line regions, as seen before during the explanation of the unified model. However, 30-50% of safer two galaxies do not show hidden broad line regions. So in conclusion, the measurement of intrinsic AGN polarization in safer galaxies is much more complicated than in quasars, where the host galaxies are barely resolved and much less contaminating. Here we can see an example of the characteristic polarization parameters of a standard equatorial scattered safer one nuclei, in concrete of Markarian 6. The polarization position angle, the polarized spectrum, the polarization degree, and the directed spectrum with a broad H-alpha emission line. The polarization spectra of equatorial scattered safers 1 nearly exhibit variations with wavelength along the broad H-alpha line in either the polarization degree and the polarization position angle. The polarization degree usually shows a central dip in the line core flanked by polarization peaks in the winds, and the polarized flux and the polarization position angle present a blue-red swing, although in average the polarization position angle is parallel to the system axis, as seen before. This shrinking change in the polarization parameters means that the scattering region resolves the broadline region. Let's consider the broadline region as a rotating broadline emitting disk centered on a point like source C at some intermediate inclination angle to the observer's line of sight, which is perpendicular to this line, no? So the rotating broad line emitting disk is surrounded by a coplanar ring of scattering medium, although here only one coplanar scattering element is represented for simplicity. Okay? Since the emitting disk is rotating, the scattering element will see blue and redshift emission from points B and A respectively. The scattering angle from blue shifted and redshifted points will be slightly different, giving rise to the blue red swing in the polarization position angle. On the other hand, all scattering elements around the ring have edge on view of the disk, and thus the elements see a broader emission line profile than the direct line of sight. As a result, the emission line profile in direct and polarized light is narrower than in a scattered polarized light, and the combination of scattered and direct line emission results in wavelength-dependent dilution of the polarized component in the line core. With the addition of the underlying continuum, the observed percentage polarization increases relative to the continuum polarization in the winds, but drops to a minimum below that level in the core. The broad H-alpha lines in direct light do not in general exhibit double peaked profiles, suggesting that the second H-alpha emitting component of the broad line region is present in addition to the disk emitting region. And this is how carrying out modeling the polarization parameters give us the valuable kinematic and structural information of the unresolved broadline region. This is one of the great and wonderful potentials of AGM polarization. This specific change on the polarization degree and in the polarization position angle through the line profile tell us that broad emission lines are emitting from a rotating disk. Even the polarization position angle can be used to measure the black hole mass. Let's discuss now about the use of optical polarimetry as a diagnostic tool for changing looks. Let's remember that two main possible mechanisms can explain the change of look, either a variable obscuration case or the intrinsic variations in the accretion rate, which will switch on and off the central source, as here. Since the broad line region is supposed to be maintained by the strength of the accretion, the broad line region will also evolve with the accretion rate. Let's also remember that a clear dichotomy is in the optical polarization degree of quasars, since in type 1 both scattering regions are intercepted, and in type 2 the equatorial scattering regions is blocked by the observing torus, so only the polar scattering light reaches us, resulting in high polarization degree. To have a better understanding, let's focus on a transition from type 1 to type 2 where the broad emission lines disappear. In type 2 objects, we had the low polarization degrees because of both scattering regions cancel respectively. However, if the change of look was performed by an obscuration cloud belonging to the torus, our view of the equatorial scattering region will be blocked in cancellations between the scattering regions. Does not occur anymore, and the polarization will significantly increase. We cannot forget that this scenario requires intermediate inclinations to intercept the obscuring material. Okay. On the contrary, if the accretion rate decreases until switching off the central source, the polarization degree is not expected to perform streaking variations, since our view of the scattering regions is not modified. So in conclusion, if the change of look is driven by intrinsic variations, we cannot see a change in the
polarizations in the polarization from one state to the next state. Measurement, the optical broadband polarization of a sample of 13 Chinook quasars, we have found, well, 7 of them being in a type 2 state, we have found that all quasars but one, the polarization degree is lower than 1%. This means that the change of look of or appearance or disappearance of the broad emission lines cannot be attributed to dust oscuration in this sample, but to intrinsic variations of the accretion rate, since every quasar, type 1 and type 2 mostly, presents low polarization rates. The one highest polarized quasar, GO26, is classified as type 2 and show a polarization degree of 6.8%. While this polarization could be due to obscuration, the time needed by a cloud from the torus to eclipse the broad light region is around 80 years, specifically for GO226. While the time scale of the observed broad emission line disappearance is approximately 6 years. Instead, we propose that this high polarization is due to the echo of a past bright phase seen in polar scattered light that was still reaching us at the moment of the observation. This is because a time delay is expected between an intrinsic dimming of the continuous seen in direct light and the dimming of the scattered continuum seen in polarized light when the quasar is seen at intermediate high inclinations, while the light scattered by the smaller quadrant scattering region suffers a little delay in comparison with the chain look time scale. The light scattered in polar regions extending over tens to hundreds of parsecs still reaches the observer decades to centuries after the direct light. In this case, the polarized light contains the echo of a past bright phase, let's dilute it by a much fainter direct light, then resulting in a high polarization degree despite the unabsorbed case. Unless another change of looks occur, obviously. We are analyzing a sample of Cypher Galaxy 5 so far to check broadband polarization in low luminosity AGN, taking into account the contamination from starlight and blah, 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 to check if these results can be extended to the low luminosity edge of AGN. Recently, we have performed spectropolarimetry in Markarian 1018, a well-known Chinook Cypher galaxy, which has undergone a cycle of transitions from 1979 to 2018, having polarimetric data in 1886 and 2018. These are sub-classifications. The higher is the sub-number, the weaker is the broad component. In type 1 point AGN's broad emission beta disappear, while H alpha is very faint. The polarization of the continuum measured in 2019 is very small and approximately 0.2%, and identical within uncertainties to the polarization measured in 1980. When Markarian 1018 was in a brighter type 1.2 state. The fact that the AGN polarization does not vary in the 1.5 state respect to the brightest 1.2 state suggest that the changes of look are driven by intrinsic variations in agreement with former works and analysis on this source. The low polarization degree suggests that the polarization is contaminated, as usual in safer galaxies, by an spurious source. We estimated a polarization degree for the host galaxy of the same order, 0.2%. So probably the polarization of the nuclear region mostly originates from the host galaxy. However, changes seen across H-alpha confirms that some polarization originates from the AGN itself. The asymmetry observed in the polarization profile together with the absence of polarization eigen rotation could indicate that H-alpha originates in an outflow along the AGN polar axis rather than in a rotation disk like seen before. Alternatively, the dip in the polarization degree precisely corresponds to a blue wing of the profile that significantly brightened between 2015 and 2019. We may thus speculate that the light from this part of the profile is less polarized than the red part due to the time delay between the direct and the polarized light, taking the polarized light and more time to reach, as seen before too. It is interesting to perform polarization monitoring of changing looks in order to get constraints in both the scattering regions and the broadline region. Coming back to true to agents, let's remember that while showing a tight to optical spectra, they are unabsorbed in X-rays. Theoretical models predict that the broadline region disappears below a certain critical value of the accretion rate and or luminosity. If the region where the broad emission lines are formed disappears, the emission lines disappears too. So we will see an optical type 2 spectrum independently of the inclination. However, some exceptions show high accretion rates, which seem to contradict the general accepted explanation. True to AGNs should be observed in polarized light to confirm that the broadline region is physically absent. We have performed several observing runs in polarized light of two candidates, but it is essential to define a detectability limit of high-dim broadline regions in polarized light to ensure their absence or presence. Actually, this limit has never been defined, and sometimes misclassifications are found due to the data quality. Because of being absorbed through to AGN, candidates are expected to exhibit very low polarization. Spectropolarimetry is very time consuming, even more for expected low polarized source. So we are checking in a first step if we can detect a high polarized continuum, which confirms that observing a single true-to candidate in spectropolarimetry is worth it. With high polarized continuum, I mean to observe in imaging polarimetry instead in spectropolarimetry. We are comparing our broadband polarimetric data of a sample of 14 to AGN with simulations to establish in this first step a limit in the continuum polarization to detect later hidden broadline regions in spectropolarimetry. The result will be presented soon. The candidates accomplish that limit will be observed in spectropolarimetry observations in X-rays will reveal details onto the accretion physics to clarify the ambiguity of high-low accretion rates. So in as main conclusions for this talk, polarimetry put constraints in both the scattering regions and in the broadline region. It is a useful diagnostic tool for changing look again. Polarimetric monitoring of changing look AGNs driven by intrinsic variations will give us the unique opportunity of studying the evolution of the broadline region. And polarimetry is clearly essential to confirm true to AGN. In general, polarization monitoring will reveal the nature of the still unknown equatorial scattering region and therefore also the characteristics of the broadline region. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you have enjoyed a little bit.
Thank you, Bea, for this interesting talk. And now, well, let's see if anybody have comment or question. Please, there is a possibility where say reacciones. You can put your hands on and see if to check a question. Well, I say if not, let me ask you something, because I miss, you know, that I am very interested in at X-rays.
Yes.
In particular, in Markarian 10, 18,
yeah.
When it was at the highest state, we saw at X-rays that the warm absorber was on, and we observed some surfaces in this. Can you say something about that in relation to the polarization or
changing look scenario? Well, to see changes of polarization in these scales where the surface is formed, presumably emitted by the accretion disk, we should move to X-ray polarimetry. We kind of check the signatures of the accretion disks in the optical. So I cannot say much about this, but in a changing look driven by intrinsic variations, we should expect a variation also in the surface stress. And performing monitorings of, for example, Markarian 18, even in X-rays, to see this change in the surface stress, can put constraints in the broader region too. And in the, let's say better in the emitting region of the broad emission lines.
So the point is that, well, what looked to me is that the variation are more related to change in accretion that in column densities.
Yes, in the case of Markarian 1018, yes, it is.
And I don't know if from the work you are doing in polarization, mm-hmm. this happened also that in general, your data suggests more than they are related to the chain in accretion.
And actually the plot show here, mm-hmm. well, not only the plot. Well, since we have not detected a change of the polarization degree in both epochs, they are not exactly a transition from type 1 to type 2, but from type 1.2 to type 1.9. So we should expect an increase in the polarization with such a brightening, and we see exactly the same value of the polarization between two states. So this is another confirmation that actually Markarian 1018 is driven by intrinsic variations. There are also another studies confirming this, I think from infrared and also from X-rays, if I am not wrong.
Okay, thank you. Marcel have his hand on. Mark,
yes. Yes, hello. Thanks, Bea, for a very, very interesting talk with new results, and also and especially with the review of the background, which is complex and is already being is beginning to be quite long. It's been many years since the work of Antonucci to really use polarimetry as a different eye to understand AGNs. Question: is the what are the best instruments to do this kind of work related to this? Since polarimetry tends to be a photon-starved technique, would you be asking for polarimetry, good spectral polarimeters on 10-meter class telescopes like the Gran Tecan? And third question, do the polarimetry techniques also work for the work on to understand microquasars, like black holes at the stellar scales? Thanks.
Thank you, Mark, for your questions. Actually, it is the time consuming, which is spectropolarimetry and polarimetry in general, is our main problem. Since analyzing polarized light, we should split the incoming light into beams, we are like losing intensity. We have like the half of the intensity to analyze, no? So this is a really handicap for faint source. And actually, for example, I don't know, till magnitudes of 18, we can go through medium size telescopes like William Herschel telescope. I am using the Herschel a lot, but I try to explain my methodology, since imaging polarimetry being broad bound requires like spectropolarimetry is eight times more time consuming. We go first through imaging polarimetry, which is less time consuming, to analyze the continuum of polarization. Why? Because with a high continuum of polarization, we can ensure that going then for applying one light of spectropolarimetry in the VLT to observe only one source is worth it. Because if we have already a low polarization degree in broadband polarimetry, we are sure that we are never get anything in spectropolarimetry. So this is our technique to save time regarding this. And I don't know if I am forgetting some questions. I am mainly using the William Herschel telescope at the Roque de los Muchachos in La Palma, and then also the BLT for fainter source. And overall, for spectropolarimetry, it's better going to the VLT always, because spectropolarimetry is much more time consuming. But as we all know, it's not really easy to get time there. So, well, we are always trying to present a really good observing proposals.
Yeah, thanks. My last question was about the microquasars.
The microquasars, okay. So I am not much knowledge about this. I don't know if... I think I cannot help too much on this. Probably with the micro lensing or lacing, we can... I don't know, sorry. It's totally out of my scope.
Yeah, I suppose since we don't have a torus usually around a stellar black hole, or we believe we don't have, then you wouldn't have this importance of looking at the scattering of the light, I suppose. But you would have an accretion disk in any case, which also would have polarization properties. So mm-hmm. Might be interesting.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Good, thanks. Thanks very much. Good talk.
For your interest. Yeah.
Thank you. More question? Suggestion? Cristina.
May I? Beatriz, thank you. Thanks for the talk. When you mentioned the two scattering regions, so yeah. Do we know, I mean, is there like a consensus on what does the scattering in the polar direction? Is it dust? Is it electrons? Is both?
As far as I know, it's not established. And I think in the polar scattered is actually both electron and dust scattering. And then in the quaternary scattering region, since it is located inside the dust sublimation radius, it is supposed that the scattering is mainly driven by electron scattering, because it is really compact and situated inside the sublimation radius of the dust.
The polar scattering region?
No. The equatorial. Then in the polar scattering, it should be mainly driven by dust and by gas.
Okay. And I was thinking that may be related with the polar dust, no? That they are claiming to be so important in the infrared, at least in some objects, no? Perhaps. I mean.
Yes. Actually, in NGC 1068, there are some clues for mid-infrared interferometry, right?
Yeah. For example, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes.
Nice. Thanks.
But there are information on 5548, because 5548 have a strong outflows with dust and gas in the polar region, so I don't know if there have been studies on polarization.
I don't come up with any study on this source on polarization.
We have to think on this subject, of course. Mm-hmm. There are more questions. I don't see any. René, do you see any question? No.
I don't have any raised hand.
So let me thank Bea again, because this is the presentation of Bea in society in the IA, in the IAA. So that thank you, and we hope in the future we will talk more about this interesting new topic that I forgot about. I did something many years ago. So thank you. And thank you to all the attenders. Yeah, I know that this morning have been crowded of things, so that is really great that some people came to listen there. So thank you very much.
Thanks to to everyone to thank to us for inviting me, and thank you for the attenders for being there listening.